We said that to implement locks easily, we need atomic instructions that are going to both read and write memory. There are three main types of such instructions. The first type is an atomic exchange instruction, something like this. The parameters for this instruction look like the parameters for a load or a store, but what an exchange does, it does both a load and a store at the same time so that it swaps the content of R1 with the contents of the memory location that it addresses. So a load would read this and put it in R1. A store would take what's in R1 and put it here. An exchange swaps the contents of the two. So the register gets what was in the memory location, and the memory location gets what was in the register. If we have an atomic exchange, what we can do is put 1 into R1, and then repeatedly, as long as R1 is equal to 1, exchange R1 with our lock variable. So this is the idea. R1 being 1, we are exchanging our R1 with the lock variable. We start out with 1 in R1. When we swap them, if the memory location for the lock had a 0, it becomes 1 in the same instruction that gets us a 0. If we do get a 0, we exit this loop and the lock variable has become 1. If, however, the lock was already occupied, then we swap 1 with 1. R1 stays 1, so we keep looping. So until we succeed in obtaining a 0, we will loop here just as before. But also, as we are getting our 0, we are atomically setting the lock variable to 1, so nobody else can also observe a 0. Pretty much, if we get a 0 in our R1, that means that everybody else who tried to do this at about the same time will get our 1. If somebody else did this before us, then we would be getting their 1 in our R1. So the fact that we are reading 0 here means that we are the ones who acquired the lock. So atomic exchange gives us this read and write at the same time behavior that we want to implement our locks. And as you can see, the lock function can be now very simple. The drawback of the atomic exchange operation is that it keeps writing to the memory location all the time, even while the lock is busy, while the lock has been locked by somebody else. So as long as we are doing this, we will be doing these writes, even though we are just getting a 1 all the time. So the second main type of atomic instructions is a whole family of things that can be classified as test and then write. So the idea is that we test the location, and if it satisfies some conditions, then we're going to write, but we don't write all the time. So let's say we have some sort of a test and store instruction, which behaves like this. We read the memory location that we are addressing, and if that location is 0, then we store R1 into it, and in that case, R1 becomes 1. But if the location wasn't 0, then we don't store anything to that location, we just return a 0. So the idea here is that we are testing whether the lock is free. If it is free, then we try to write a 1 in it. If it's not free, then we simply continue. There is no point in trying to write to a lock that we know is not free. So we are avoiding the writes that happen in the exchange while the lock is actually not free. So this behaves very similarly to the exchange, except that it only does the write if the lock has the unlocked state.